Support for That 90s Wrestling Podcast has been brought to you by Manscaped, who is the best in men's below-the-waist grooming. Manscaped offers precision engineering tools for your family jewels. Manscaped is trusted by over 2 million men worldwide. Join the movement for all your below-the-waist grooming needs and get 20% off plus free delivery. And all you have to do is use my code 90s, that's 90s. Use that at manscaped.com, and like I said before, you get 20% off and also you get free shipping to anywhere around the world. So, thanks for that, and please enjoy the show. Wrestling Podcast. I'm your host James Tipton, and today's special guest, he's not just a cooler, he is ECW World Champion, Mr. The One and Only, Justin. Incredible. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine. How are you, sir?
Good, thanks. We had a quick chat off camera about the craziness of COVID, but it's nice to just talk about some wrestling.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Cool. So, how's things over there? It's all good and things brightening up?
Things are okay. I'm going to be part of WrestleMania weekend, which is coming up next week. I'm going to be doing a couple of conventions, wrestling conventions, and a toy convention, like action figure convention. So, that's in Florida, for those that don't know, and that's been pretty open. So far, only, like I said to you off camera, only wrestling in Florida and Texas is really kind of what's going on. I mean, there are other places, but, the mainstream, it's still very, it's very tough to get booked. So I'm just blessed to at least have that. I'm just looking forward for this as I'm sure a lot of people around the world are just looking for this to go away, hopefully soon, so we could all get back to work, because it's really hit hard, the entertainment industry, music, I'm sure people that do theater, professional wrestling obviously is huge, even though it has a very select group of fans, as you know. But I just can't wait to get back out there. I miss it dearly. You know, I miss traveling the world.
Yeah, it's the same. I spoke to some UK wrestlers, exact same thing. Not allowed any gatherings or anything like that. And same sort of thing. They're just trying to do other stuff to keep themselves busy. But hopefully we'll be getting across that line and start having some shows again. But it's been a nightmare, but there you go. So cool. So we'll get to the beginning of your career. So training under the Harts. What was that like? I can imagine that was an experience.
It was a heck of an experience. I mean, I got involved in wrestling. I mean, I was always a fan. Not always, but I would say I became a real, real fan when, I was a kid, maybe 10 years old, 11 years old, when Iron Sheik lost the title to Hulk Hogan. Yeah. And I remember my mom and dad are working class folks. They had the one color TV in the main room, in the living room, whatever, I know in the UK it's different, but you know what I'm saying? Like the living room area where the couches are and stuff. And in my bedroom, I had a black and white TV with the antennas. And I caught a New York station because I live about 90 miles, and I know you do kilometers, but about 120 kilometers from New York City. Right. And I caught Hulk Hogan by chance, because my cartoon didn't come on for some reason. I caught Hulk Hogan pinning the Iron Sheik, and I'm like, what is this? I was just, my mind was blown. I'd never seen pro wrestling before. And that was it. I was hooked. So growing up, I wasn't very good at school. Not that I wasn't smart. I think I was, but I just wasn't, there was nothing pulling me except pro wrestling, which is a problem right there. When I was 18 years old, I went to a Catholic high school, which my parents paid extra for, just to, college, to prepare you for college. Long story short, I was working the year after I graduated just to save up some money. And I told my folks, quote unquote, that I was going to go to school the following year. I just needed a year to kind of figure out what I wanted to do. So as I was working in a grocery store, I went to the aisle on my break where they sell magazines. And of course it was Pro Wrestling Illustrated that I was reading. And this is pre-internet, of course. And there was a a full page article for the Hart Brothers Pro Wrestling Camp. Right. And I responded to the ad. There was a phone number, and it was Bruce Hart that answered the phone. And I was like, wow, I couldn't believe it. And I made the commitment. So I went to the Hart Brothers in 92 after I saved up enough money. And on my 19th birthday, October 16th, 1992, was my first ever pro wrestling match in Calgary, Alberta, Canada.
Awesome. Yeah. And I think you met Lance Storm and Chris Jericho during your time there. Was that right?
I did, yeah. Chris Jericho was my fourth match ever, believe it or not.
Oh, well, wow.
I mean, he had not had the success yet that he has. I mean, we're both young and green.
Yeah.
Although he had been to Japan maybe, a couple of times for FMW. And, got to work with him. But Lance was... him and Chris had come through the camp, the Hart Brothers camp, a year and a half before I did. And Lance kind of stuck around to train, really, because the Harts, they were great and everything. But Lance was the one that was in the ring. You know what right. I'm saying? Like doing the drills and stuff. And the Harts would come by for a little bit, and do some stuff in the ring, maybe throw you around a little, give you a talk. But Lance was really the... You know what I'm saying? The meat and potatoes of the whole thing. He was great. And he only had probably a year and a half experience at that time. He was just so good.
Yeah, I mean, we'll talk more about Lance later, but I've always said he's one of the most underrated workers I've ever known. Like every match sure. I watch him, I always enjoy it. So
yeah, he's great. He's very and you wouldn't believe it. And I hate to say these things, even though kayfabe is dead for a long time, but you could barely feel him. I don't think he's ever stiffed me once, not once. And we've wrestled on hundreds of times. He's brilliant. He's amazing. So I was very lucky.
Awesome. And it wasn't long after this. You joined WWE at first as an enhancement talent, but then getting the contract. So where did the – I think one of your first matches as an enhancement talent was against Lex Luger. So what was Lex Luger like? I've heard, mixed opinions about him. What was your experience with him?
Well, I mean, Lex was he was a little bit of – not a big – he wasn't a big dick or anything, but he kind of – he was cool to your face, but you could tell he was a little bit of a prick. You could. Right. You just could. But, he was a nice guy deep down inside. And I've talked to Lex recently,
Yeah.
And he was not a bad dude. Everybody, handles that shit differently. Success, fame, trying to hold on to your spot. But that's another story. But Lex was cool. He's totally easy to work with. I was a jobber. So, let's call a spade a spade. But he was super cool, didn't hurt me, which was, I was so frightened. I'm a 19-year-old kid, and I walk into the locker room for the first time, and there's, Macho Man Randy Savage, there's Vince McMahon, Gorilla Monsoon, Yokozuna. I mean, the list goes on and on, dude. Yeah. It was just the Steiners, whatever, it's just like everybody's there, and I'm like, I'm a little kid compared to these men. And then going out there and even though the building itself only held maybe 700-800 people at the Manhattan Center where they taped those early Raws, very small. But still, it's like the bright lights are shining on you. And then you go out, they cut to commercial. So you have about 2 minutes and there's Vince, sitting at ringside, and Bobby Heenan. And I'm like, you're like, Jesus Christ. it was scary, but it was a great experience. It was a great experience, obviously. It's like, welcome to the show.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
And they gave you the Aldo Montoya gimmick. And if I've got this right, so originally you was meant to be a football player, or as you call it, a soccer player.
Yeah, I'm Portuguese, so I understand the football thing. I was supposed to be a football player. Yeah.
Yeah, but was it true that you're not a fan of football, so they changed it?
Oh, no, not at all. I'm actually a huge fan of football. I played all throughout high school. I was actually pretty decent. I was a right wing, offensive player, as they call it in the States. But no, I guess they just they didn't think the gimmick would work. So they went with the more because the Power Rangers were very big in that era.
Yes.
And they made Aldo, the original drawings at least, Aldo looked like a Power Ranger. He looked like a badass right. Power Ranger. And I ended up getting the shoulder pads, because the drawing had me in Road Warrior shoulder pads. And right. when I debuted, like, things were so bad in the WWF at the time, and nobody understands. Vince was on trial for the steroids.
That's right.
And stuff. And so money was really bad. So when I debuted, I literally got my gear 2 hours before I went on.
Oh, wow.
And I was supposed to have these cool-looking shoulder pads. And, of course, you would want to look the best you could on your debut. I didn't get those till like, weeks later, maybe months later.
Right.
Because there was only two girls, and they spent most of the time on HBK's pay-per-view shit. Not, you know what I mean? That's just how it yeah. was, you know? But anyways, the design looked great. I was just happy to be there. So I did the best with Aldo as I could, you know, as a young man. I mean, who am I to say anything? I'm a contracted WWF wrestler at 21. Yeah. You know, I was like, I'm just happy to be here, you know, learning, you know?
Definitely. And, one year, the first guys he became pals with was Scott Hall. As we call him, old Razor Ramon. So,
bet you got
some fun stories with Razor.
Yeah, you know, I started my first. I got signed originally. The first time I ever signed a contract was August 1st, 1994. I was still jobbing as PJ Walker. I had beat IRS Mike Rotundo in a squash match. He was supposed to squash me, but then Razor and him were doing an angle. So due to Razor's distraction, I rolled him up. Well, after that happened, WWF put me on the road doing house shows, live events, however people want to call them. And from that moment, the first trip, I'm a kid. I can't even rent a car. I mean, I had a credit card. You know, my mom co-signed for me, but I still, like, you had to be at that time. It doesn't exist today, but you had to be like 25 to rent a vehicle. Right. And so I got to the airport for my first ever tour, and I couldn't rent a car. So I had to go with Tony Garea, Pat Patterson, and Rene Goulet, which is The Office. Yeah. And Razor asked me when I got to the building, "Who are you traveling with, puss?" And I'm like, Tony and Pat and, you know, Rene Goulet. And he goes, "Bro, you're gonna get so much heat traveling with The Office."
Yeah.
He goes, "You coming with me from now on." So from that moment on, Scott and I were road buddies. As if we were on the same schedule, that is, I traveled with him, you know, and learned a lot from him as well.
Oh yeah. You know? Yeah. Everyone's always said he's one of the most brilliant minds when it comes to wrestling. He came up with the crow gimmick for Sting. So
Yeah. No, he was pretty good. I mean, he was, Scott's a lot of things. You know, we all know, so I don't have to say it. But one of the things he did love was is pro wrestling, and he was very good at it, you know? So yeah, I give him credit for that. And he loved hanging out with younger kids. It sounds creepy the way I said it. Younger talent, because he wanted, he was a little older. So he wanted to what's cool in society? What are the kids listening to? You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm in my 30s. What are the 20-somethings listening to as far as culture? You know what I mean? Dress, you know? But that's smart of him. You know, you want to stay with the times. And that's something I learned from him. To this day, I still try to use, because if you're in the entertainment business, you want to stay with what's relevant. You know, you don't want to do stuff, you know, that was being done 20 years before. You know what I mean? Because the kids aren't going to get into it. So his transformation kind of kept him relevant throughout his progression until later on, but you know, which is fine. He's just doing his old NWO shtick. But if you think about it, it was quite legendary what the move that he made really started the Monday Night Wars, you know?
Yeah. Cool. And you made your pay-per-view debut at the 95 Royal Rumble. And I suppose the big angle of the night was Pamela Anderson. And she was the number one woman at the time. And as he was a 21-year-old. And I think at the beginning of the show, I actually spoke to Duke Drosy about this. You were all huddled around the limousine waiting for her to come out. So what was she like to be around?
Oh, she was cool. I actually met her years later. Right. Because I was friends with Kid Rock, like outside of the business. Like we were really, really good friends. And his DJ, Uncle Cracker, Matt Schaefer is his real name. His brother was my manager.
Right.
So I had, I'd hung out and partied with Kid Rock and Pam. Like I'd been into their hotel room, smoked a little pot, you know, totally cool. But back then I didn't know her at all, but, probably one of the nicest people, like most genuine people in a beautiful, like angelic body. She was absolutely stunning. It was pretty cool. Pretty surreal, actually.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. My dad was a big fan of Baywatch every week. So
who wasn't? Who wasn't? Yeah, right. Six. That's funny.
Awesome. Speaking of funny, Owen Hart, the King of Ribs. What was Owen like to be around, and did he ever pull any famous ribs on you?
Owen was fantastic. He was such an anomaly of what people would expect from wrestlers. He was, you know, he wrestled. He was one of the boys. But when everybody was in, you know, not everybody, but most people, when you wrestle, you don't have any other life other than travel in a car, go to eat, go to the gym, and then repeat and wrestle and do the same thing again. But the bar was the only social thing we had. Not to be, you know, an alcoholic or to just drink. It was just a way to chat with some folks. Yeah. And Owen never did that. He was a family man. He'd go to his room, you know, maybe watch a movie, order a pizza, and go to sleep. But I guess one of the ways Owen, you know, would just relax and chill was like to rib everybody. And the most famous rib that he did to everybody all the time, it was predictable as the weather. And you know, it was when we'd go on a European tour, we would always get in early, a day early is what I'm saying. And then he would wait, literally rib himself by staying up till about 3 or 4 in the morning. And back in those days, we had a pamphlet, like an envelope full of information. And it was in that envelope was everyone's real name and their hotel room.
Right.
So Owen would literally go down the list of everyone, like as we're trying to go to sleep and cause we got to get up early for the bus. Cause back then, and I still think it is today, like, you know, the heels get on one bus, the baby faces get on another, but you have to be downstairs at like 7 a.m. So Owen would call you at about 4 in the morning and be like, hello, you know, with a horrible British accent. Would you like some breakfast? And like, you know, I was always with Razor. So Scott's like, no, we're tired. We're trying to sleep. We'd hang up. 5 minutes later, we'd fall back and say, would you like some tea with that? And he would just keep going on and on to the point one night Scott actually threw the phone and broke it because Owen just kept calling and asking what, you know, if he'd like to change our orders and whatnot. And then it just got so funny that one time Scott actually called down to the office after Owen kept harassing him. And he's like, actually, breakfast sounds nice. Could you just bring up the order? And they're like, what order? Because it was Owen the whole time. So Owen was just cool like that. He was just, you know, he'd rib himself to rib you. That's the best I could say. You know, he's just a great guy.
Yeah, and I suppose you could say he's tag team partner in ribbing Davey Boy. Just been inducted into Hall of Fame. Brett Reserve, which as a UK guy, my two guys growing up was obviously him and Brett, but I can imagine some fun stories with Davey Boy as well.
I have a really good one, and it has to do with us being in London. This is in 95. It was me, Davey Boy, and a couple other boys. I'm not sure who they were. But Mike Chioda, remember Mike Chioda, the referee?
Yeah.
Okay, he was down there as well. So we're all hanging out, and Chioda's starting to, the referee Mike, he's starting to get a little cocky, you know, talking shit, and Davey goes, Aldo, make sure you keep him right here. And Davey goes to the room, and I'm like, what the fuck's he doing? So about 10 minutes later, Davey comes back with a pair of clippers, hair clippers.
Yeah.
And, you know, Mike's still kind of rambling, but he's really starting to get tipsy. So Davey Boy turns to me and he goes, all right, Aldo, I slipped 2 gimmicks in his beer. Give him about 10 minutes, he'll be passed out. Lo and behold, he passed out right at the bar. Davey Boy clipped a Road Warrior Hawk style thing. And So whatever, everybody wakes him up. The marks were all there, you know, because how it is in London, you know, the fans come out to the hotels, yeah. which is great. I miss that. Yeah. So Mike wakes up. He kind of doesn't know what's going on. He goes, and I'll never forget. I don't remember what hotel we were at, but we go out, and there were mirrors all down the hall. Mike wakes up enough to look at himself, you know, half bald with this road warrior haircut. And I have never seen a human being straighten up so quick, like kick out of the haze. And he ran to his room, pissed off like a motherfucker. Funny part of the story, the next time we come back 6 months later to London, there were fans at the airport with pictures of Davey Boy clipping his hair. And because Davey Boy, the next couple days, oh, and this is famous Davey Boy, Mike, Kyoto, come on. I didn't do it. I wasn't even there. And then the funny thing is, there we are at the next tour, and everybody had a picture of it.
Yeah.
So that was classic Davey Boy. And his famous words were, it wasn't me. I wasn't even there.
Yeah, so to have me blame Owen.
just to have photographic evidence, though, by the fans was just so funny. It's classic Davey Boy, you know, it brings a smile to my heart.
Oh, yeah, he's greatly missed, the two of them are. So, yeah, you know, two of the good ones. So, you know, he was friends with the Kliq, and during this time, Diesel was champion. So what was Diesel like as the champion, and how did the locker room feel when compare to when he was champion and compared to, say, for example, when Brett was champ?
It was, Kevin was liked because Kevin's a really good dude. Really, really good dude, especially if you know him. And, you know, Kevin came from a different breed. Like a lot of people in wrestling with success, you could say they came from the business, maybe second generation in the business. Kevin wasn't, he really wasn't a pro wrestler at heart. He was more in the entertainment side of it. So he didn't, at first at least, he really didn't understand the politics and the bullshit that came with it. So he started to kind of pick up on it because Kevin was very smart. And then when he picked up on it, he started to kind of play his mind game, which I hate to say it, but it is true. I don't think it's true today. I really don't. But in the 90s, especially the mid to late 90s during the Attitude Era, I mean, it was. You had to play. I mean, walking into a locker room was like a political game. You know, honestly, it should have been a series on Netflix.
Oh, yeah.
Because it was deep. So, yeah, but Kevin was great, dude. Kevin was cool. He was super intelligent. And I thought he had a lot to offer. You know, fans have different feelings about him. I think he went too far in some ways. And I think he admits it today. But, you know, it's what it is. I mean, we were a bunch of guys just trying to make sense of a crazy business, because it was that was a very volatile time as well in the industry. I mean, there was so much at stake between WWF and WCW. And at the end of the day, as much as Kevin ended up liking the business later on, but we were all just trying to get paid and support our families. You know, and it was just the craziness you had to do. Like, I ran with the Kliq because A, I didn't have anybody else to run with, and B, they were the most influential. It's like, fuck, if you guys are willing to hang with me, I think I'll try to, like, I was protecting myself.
Oh, yeah.
I'd rather be safe and be your friends than not be.
Yeah.
You know, that's how it was. That doesn't happen today, but that's just the truth of it, you know?
Cool. And talk about the locker room, Undertaker. So the locker room leader, did you ever see Wrestler's Court in action or anything?
I was part of Wrestler's Court.
Oh, right.
And I don't remember why. I think it might have been, I don't even remember what I was in Wrestler's Court for, but I think it might have been me being late for a show. Because I could be wrong, but I have told this story, so I'll go ahead and try to make it entertaining and quick. We flew into Montreal. We had a 2-day run. Friday night was Quebec City. Saturday was Montreal, which was our biggest market in Canada. So we always fly into Montreal, and believe it or not, in the Montreal airport, they do not sell. There's like no good restaurants, honestly. There's like a couple of small places, nothing really good. The best place, and when you're a wrestler too, you don't know the area. There was no GPS in 95 like there is today. So you didn't want to go, you know, just driving around looking for a place. So there was a strip club 2 miles from the airport that sold, that they had a great restaurant where you can get a good steak and some rice and, you know what I mean? Like a healthier meal, not like some fast food. So, and it happens to show naked women. Double bonus, we win. So me, Sean, HBK, Waltman, Kevin, all of us, every single one of us except Hunter, were on that trip. And I don't know, I think it was Kevin or Scott. Let's go to the strip club, get some steaks, and then we'll drive to Quebec City, which was 3 hours away. Right. You know, okay. So we meet at the airport. We go, we check in, we go to the, we go to the strip club. We're all eating. Somebody mentions, hey, let's get some shots. Okay. So we're doing shots of Jack Daniels, drinking Coors Light, because that was the beer and the drink of choice. It was Coors Light because it had less calories if you like beer. Yep. And the alcohol was Jack Daniels, like the strong stuff. So after about an hour and a half, I'm piss face. I'm drunk. I'm really drunk. And I'm opening match against Quang, a.k.a. Savio Vega.
Yeah.
And we're 3 hours away. It's 5 o'clock or so. And we have a 3 hour drive. Show starts at 7:30.
Right.
So we're not going to make it. Man, there's some flurries of snow starting to come down. So anyways, we get on the road. I'm hammered. Everybody in the car is kind of hammered. I don't know. I don't remember who was driving, but I know whoever was driving was not. I will say that for sure, because we're not that stupid. But anyways, we're going down the road. And I think Kevin, who was making the most money out of all of us at the time, had one of those Paul Heyman 1990s cell phones that look like a goddamn brick.
That's right.
And he called Black Jack Lanza, who was the agent at the time, that we're right around the corner. Give, you know, Aldo will be ready. So I'm literally getting dressed in the car, still drunk. I think we might have had a 30 pack of beer in the car as well. And I'm getting my shit on. The show's already started. Quang is in the ring. I literally walk through the door from the minivan because we had to rent the biggest van they had to get all of our asses in there. And everybody else is on later, of course. So I walk through the curtain. My music's already playing. I made it, honestly, by a hair. And then I get in the ring with Quang. And, okay, I'm feeling good. It was a big fucking crowd. Everything looks great. So we're wrestling. And all of a sudden, Quang takes over, starts giving me a chop or two. I mean, hard chops in the corner. And I'm looking, and I see the boys starting to form around the curtain. I'm like, well, that's odd. Nobody really watches the opening match. So we keep wrestling. The match is going great. The crowd is hype. You know, now it's a sellout at the curtain. You know, the more the match is progressing. And Savio's, you know, well, I call him Savio, but he was wrestling under Quang. Yeah. Now, when he sees everybody's at the curtain, it's showtime. He's just putting my arms back, whap, and he's playing to them. He goes, hey, one more? Yeah, okay. Boom, motherfucker, there you go. Literally, that's what he would say to me. They were literally, Mark was behind the curtain, and Savio was talking to Mark, and Mark would give him the thumbs up or thumbs down if he wanted another chop. So I had about 30 chops, hard ones. But Savio ended up putting me over. The match actually ended up, because the chops were so good, and the match looked, you know, especially for an opening jobber match, was really good. Like everybody won. But I think that's what that's why I went to wrestler's court for being late. I think. I don't remember. It was a long time ago. But the story definitely happened, that's for sure.
Awesome. And one of the main talents during this time, and you worked with him in both WWE and ECW, Sonny. So many stories told about Sonny, like apparently, she was with Sean, and she says her and Candido were split up. Other people was like, Candido knew, but he just didn't want to accept it. So What was your experience?
She was okay. My experience, and I know Sean was with her, and Chris did know, but one of the most obvious ones, because I loved Chris. Chris was the guy that helped get me in ECW. And I'll say this real quick, and I'll get back to this Tammy thing. When I was in USWA, Jerry Lawler's territory, ECW was down there doing the angle with Lawler. And Chris happened to be there for ECW, and I was there for USWA after Aldo. And Chris asked me to come to ECW. He talked to Paul. Paul talked to Vince. That's how the deal was made. So Chris was always a good friend. And so one day, there we're in some town. They had Sean Waltman and Billy Gunn on lookout watching Candido's match as Skip. And I think Tom Pritchard was there too. That doesn't matter. But Sean would sneak into Sonny's locker room because back then she was the only one on the road. So the women's locker room was strictly for Sonny. Yeah, so Sean would go in there and do his business. So they would be watch out. And when the match was over, they would come and knock on the door. So one day she was wearing a very puffy, yet like something that you would, if, put it this way, Sean had a beard at the time. Yeah. And literally shit would stick to its face from the sweater. Yeah. And as he's, they warned Sean that he's coming through the curtain, and Sean literally runs into Chris, like crisscrossing Candido with white shit all on his face and her sweater. Like literally. And he goes like this, "Oh, sorry, kid, I gotta go." Gives him a sportsman, slaps him in the ass, and runs off with the white shit all on his face. Like, really, dude? You didn't catch that whole thing? So that's the one story I have. But she was bad, man. She was real bad. She tried to have sex with me. When I stayed with them, because back in the day we would travel together, and one day they stayed at my mom and dad's house when we were doing house shows, and they returned the favor. I was staying with them at Tammy's mom's house, and when Chris was in the shower, Tammy came up to me with a towel on, and I was sleeping on the floor, and took her thing off and said, "Fuck me right here," and being that I'm in my friend's house, I played it off like as a joke, like she was ribbing, and I put the covers over my head. I'm like, "Stop, leave me alone, ha ha ha." She was dead ass serious, bro.
Wow.
I wouldn't do that to a friend. You invite me into your house and do that's just dirty. Nobody's that good looking, dude. That's just she was just like that. She was just a bad human.
Yeah. Everyone's always said, like, Chris Candido was the nicest person.
The sweetest man in the world. Sweetest man in the world.
And they said, like, for example, like, say, today's wrestling, like, NXT and that, how perfect of a spot it would be for Chris Candido to be training all these young men and women.
Oh, yeah.
He would be
perfect
for it. It's such a shame. But you mentioned it, so you made your way towards ECW and became just incredible. So whose brainchild was that? Was it yours or was it you and Heyman, for example?
The gimmick was mine.
Yeah.
Well, no, the name was Heyman. That was his idea. But the attitude and stuff was mostly me. Paul obviously worked closely. Like he told me a couple of things that he would like to see the character be, which was kind of, he wanted me to be a cocky, just a real heel, like an old school heel. And I did this in the opening match, and it's funny, somebody posted this today on Twitter, which I happened to watch, and one of the first things that, this was a Heyman spot, he's like, get the guy in the corner, hit on him, so he's selling, and then be like, "Come on, I'm begging you to hit me right here," as he goes to hit you, thumb him in the eye, just cheap stuff, but that's what he wanted me to be, like an annoying little scumbag kind of guy.
Oh, yeah. Like when I used to watch on TV, like the best way to explain it was just like an asshole to people.
Yeah,
And that's what we miss in wrestling, because I think people, I genuinely do think people are scared to be a proper heel. They want to be a cool heel these days. Right. No one wants to be a proper asshole heel who you want to get the shit kicked out of. And that's what you were.
That's what makes money, though. Played to
perfection. Exactly.
I'm opposite of that 100%. I'm a kind, loving, quiet young man, you know. That's not me. But that's why I can do it so well, because I can get to play someone I'm completely not. I think people in the business today, younger folks, are afraid to take that commitment. It's no different. Although wrestling is much different than acting, but the character part is no different than acting. The actual wrestling is very difficult and very physical. But the acting part of it, which is part of wrestling, is not. You just have to embrace that character. I'm not a tough guy. I cry during movies, dude. I'm an emotional guy, and I'm not tough. But in the ring, I'm a different person, because that's the part I'm trying to play. And I think guys just are afraid to commit, because they think that's the way to get over. Trust me, you get over as a real hated heel. Yeah. Then if you ever turn, and you probably will, they're going to love you that much more. I mean, as long as you have the fans caring what you're doing, then you've made it. Whether they're booing you or cheering you, you just don't want them sitting on their hands when you're out there. Because if they're not giving you any reaction, that's the worst, right? So I'd rather have a room full of people hate me.
I think if there's one wrestler who I can say is trying to bring that asshole heel back, it's probably MJF, because he doesn't care, and he's a young guy. I think he's 23 or 24, he gets it. So shades of that, what I can see, like, from you being this asshole heel, and I can see it with him. He just doesn't care, and if he keeps going the way he's going, he's going to be a massive star. So how I look at it.
Yeah, I agree 100%. And he was trained right next to close enough to me from Brian Myers, Kurt Hawkins, which I've done work with MJF, and he's a very nice kid, and he has his head around it. He's very smart to the game, and he's very very willing to play that part, and it is a part. He's a great guy. So but you got to be willing to do it and not worry about what fans think. You know, sometimes, I mean, the internet is a wonderful tool to promote and to get involved in, but you can't read comments from fans, because if you do, it can, you know, because wrestlers, just like actors, I would imagine, you know, we're insecure people. So you see enough comments saying, oh, you're a jerk, or you're this, or you're that, it almost hurts your feelings. I'm sure everyone out there is trying their hardest. You just got to get used to not reading the comments, go on and do your thing. And he's one that's really kind of understood that will always work, because you want to hate somebody. Because what does a comeback mean, or even matter, if you don't, you know, if you don't care, you know, if they care enough to hate me, when that baby face turns around and starts whipping my ass, fans are going to love it. That's what you hope.
Yeah, you know? That's true.
So,
and it's great. Well said. And, so you made your way to ECW, so the locker room is infamous. So what was the big difference between the WWF locker room and the ECW locker room?
The biggest difference was everybody was friendly.
Yeah.
And not even friendly, because WWF, or, you know, WWE, but back then it was still F. It wasn't that they weren't friendly, but it was just like everyone was very much cut off. It's like, it really was like if you're going to work, like, you're not going to share everything with everyone. You're going to stay to yourself mostly, because you can't trust people. A lot of times it was not fun in the WWF. In ECW, it was just everyone was very laid back. Everyone wanted to help one another succeed. And Paul, I always say this about Paul, he's not the greatest booker or anything like that. He's a great communicator. What I mean by that is, he knew how to, like a coach does in football or American football or basketball or whatever sport, he knows how to rally up the troops, and he knows how to make you believe in you. And he knew he couldn't afford some of the best talent in the world, but he would always make you feel like, look, you know, you're the underdog. Nobody believes in you. I believe in you. Yeah. God damn it. now you go out there and you, you know, and he would give you these pep talks where you really did believe in yourself. Therefore, he got the most from each individual, which was brilliant in itself. You know, that's sometimes, man, it takes just a little bit of believing in someone for someone to actually go out there and do it. And that's where Paul was like next level. It's like, well, I don't got the money to bring in the biggest guy or the best looking guy or the best wrestler, but I'm going to make these crazy fuckers out here believe it. And we did. And what happened was greatness from a lot of these men and women, you know.
Yeah, and you got a real strong push, and but during this time, I do want to mention it. So the Montreal Screwjob happened, and I mean, it's been documented to death. But I don't know if I ever heard it being said from the ECW perspective. So when you heard what went down, what was your reaction, and what was the reaction from the locker room during that time?
I don't remember, honestly, the reaction from the locker room, but I always believed, and I still do to this day, that it was a work. Yeah. I have to believe it was a work. And I work for Vince Russo at this moment. He pays me to be on the podcasts, you know, and I'm grateful. Vince is one of the nicest, I mean, he's one of the nicest people I've met in this industry ever. I just think he's, you know, unfortunately caught a bad rap. But that being said, I don't believe what he said. I think it was all in a very one of the biggest conspiracies in the world of wrestling. Not in the world, but in the world of wrestling. I think everybody knew. I really did. I really do. Yeah. That's just
I spoke to Vince last week. Great guy. So
isn't he? And he's a really sweet dude. I love Vince.
Yeah, great guy. Cool. And so your biggest feud, like during the strong push, was Tommy Dreamer. So he's still kicking and Impact. So what was it like working with Tommy? And Tommy, you could say, was the locker room leader for ECW.
Oh yeah, I mean he definitely was locker room leader, emotional leader. He didn't get, you know, he was just so chill, like so relaxed. He just wanted everybody, like he was the voice of, like I want to say this correctly. He wasn't like a Paul Heyman stooge. He was very independent from that.
Yeah.
Yet he wanted to, he knew what was best for ECW, and he wanted to kind of to convey Paul's message the best way he could without messing with the boys. So I honestly think Tommy had one of the hardest jobs, because as he's doing Paul's work, kind of relaying storylines and, you know, because Heyman can only do so much, and getting the company to flow, he was still very pro individual wrestlers. So he was just a wonderful guy, and so much loves the business, and he was an asset. Like, he chose to work with me. And in ECW, I mean, I know it may sound corny to some people, but in ECW, Tommy Dreamer, like, if he wanted to work with you at that time, it meant something. And especially now, we're still talking about it 20-something years later. So there was just so much influence there. And I don't think any of us really understood or saw what it was going to end up, especially all these years later. But Dreamer is just... Tommy Dreamer is the heart and soul of pro wrestling. And I think that's what he always wanted to be, because he always looked up to Dusty Rhodes. You know, and I got the pleasure of working with Dusty through Dreamer, because we were doing an angle with Tommy, and I got to work with Dusty. And that was just who Tommy was. And I think he's like the true wrestling fan that just wants to, whatever's right for wrestling, Tommy will do. And he was the biggest asset to Heyman that anybody could want. And Tommy basically did it for free a lot of the times, which I commend him for, you know. Tommy was the best, and I owe him my just incredible piece of my career to him easily.
Yeah, go. Yeah. You got reunited with Lance Storm, Impact players. So what was it like tagging with Storm and becoming two-time tag team champs?
It was great. It was easy. That's the one thing I should say about ECW, is everything was easy, because we were all on the same page. Like, on the outside, it looks like we're all killing each other. Things are so stiff. It was the opposite. And I hate to say it because it's almost killing the gimmick. But, you know, Lance and I were brilliant for the reason of whatever Lance was, I was not. Like, Lance was more polished, quiet, like an assassin almost. Like, very, and I don't want to say this to bring up the wrong person, but Benoit-esque as far as precision, just from the wrestling standpoint.
Nothing else.
Just from a technician standpoint. So it's like for the Impact players to work, it's like he was that guy and I was more of the brawler, more of the DX, Scott Hall-esque showman, which Lance was not. And then we kind of mixed it together. So he started to be more, we started to do the pose, which he never would have done. No. You know, and that was the old Kevin Nash diesel pose, you know, when that's Sean would do the thing. We ripped that off. And so Lance is doing a little bit of me. I'm trying to do a little bit of Lance. And we've known, he was the first person I ever met in the business. That's so we're kind of just flowing together. We had very close ties. And it was effortless. It was so cool. It was so cool. Ugh, miss those days. So much fun.
Oh, yeah. And Dawn Marie was part of the package as well. So what was she like to work with?
She was fun. She was great, man. And beautiful young woman. I mean, and very talented, like, in the ring. I don't think, you know, a lot of times when, especially with female managers, you know, they're limited not because of what they can do, but sometimes because of their script, what they're handed, what they're, you know, told to do. But she was like next level smart, and you know, she could work actually, you know. So it was just a great combo. A lot of fun.
Yeah, it was a great team along with Jason. It was a great team altogether. And but yeah, ECW. So I can imagine he had a couple of crazy ECW stories. So care to share any?
Well, believe it or not, that's when I was the most behaved.
Oh, well.
Yeah, no, because I knew that this was a wonderful opportunity as far as work, and I embraced it. And also, I just got married to my wife, who I'm still married to this day. I married my wife in 1997. So congrats. I was married. Thank you. I was married from day one when I joined ECW. I was already married. So I would we would travel together. My wife actually worked for ECW. From the minute we signed on till the close, she did merchandise, which was Tommy Dreamer's department. Right. So Tommy gave her a job. So I wouldn't party. We would finish the show and go home.
Yeah.
So yeah, it was very boring, but not boring. It was actually quite nice because, you know, I got to laser focus on the job at hand, you know, but I never, I never hung out, believe it or not.
Yeah.
You know? Cool. Yeah.
Someone who wasn't born, Sabu, and you worked a great program with him. So what's it like working with Sabu, one of the all-time greats?
He was great. I mean, very unorthodox, but not as crazy. I mean, he's how do you explain Sabu? Here's a typical Sabu. You know, if you're in the ring, he likes to call a lot of the stuff improvised out there. And he would put you on a table and be like, just hold your breath. I'm like, what? Hold your breath. 5 seconds later, he's coming off the top through a table on the floor. And you're like, that's what you meant. That's it. I mean, you know, it was nothing like, you know, he was just he was a lot better than I think people, you know, because he always gets kind of put out there that, you know, he missed a lot of stuff, and sometimes he was like a 50-50 shot if he would hit the move. But the stuff he was trying to do was like off the charts. Like, I don't think he gets enough credit sometimes for innovating as much as he did in the business. Yeah. He took a lot of chances, and a lot of the shit was just like, hey, I'm going to try this crazy thing. Let's see if I could pull it off. Yeah. And when he did, it was brilliant. When he didn't, it was the shits. So it was like a roll of the dice with Sabu. You didn't know which one you were going to get. But to this day, I'm still cool with him. I still talk to him. I love Sabu. He's a great dude. Very influential because he changed the style up in the 90s because people weren't doing a lot of that stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So
awesome. And I mean, we've mentioned Tommy a few times, but you defeated him for the world title. So,
yes.
What was it like becoming world champion?
Something I never thought would have happened. I never, especially for me, I was, you know, I'm 6 foot at the time, 6 foot, 230 pounds. Today I'm much heavier because I'm fat, but but even back then at 230, you were considered in the WWF landscape smallish. You know, because I remember as Aldo, Owen and I were the smallest guys in the locker room.
Right.
Just by weight. So you are always told you're going to be either a jobber or a light heavyweight, which is just as good as being a jobber. When I beat Dreamer, I didn't even know. Like, I got to the show. I didn't beat Dreamer, but when I was told I was going over on Dreamer, I got to the show. I wasn't on the list because they just literally put up a white page with Heyman's writing, and I didn't have any matches on it. I was like, huh, because Lance and I were tag champions the time. And I'm like, huh, but okay, I'm getting paid no matter what. I'm not going to say shit. What am I complaining about? Free night. So about an hour and a half beforehand, Paul comes up to me and explains everything to me. And literally, we're at intermission, and this is like getting close to the end of the show, and he's telling me this now. Yeah. And he's like, get dressed. I'm like, okay. And he ran it down, and I was like, really? Like, I thought it was a rib.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't see myself coming out of there like that. So, you know, I know it sounds very markish, but becoming a world champion, and I don't know how far back in pro wrestling you go, but for me as a kid, there were always three promotions. It was the AWA, WWF, and WCW/NWA, whichever.
Yeah.
And now there was WCW, ECW, and WWF. So I'm the world champion of one of the big three in America.
That's right. Yeah.
That's a big deal. I never thought I would become a world. I mean, there's not a lot of world champions. Yeah. And like all of a sudden I'm a world champion. It's like, and it's not because I beat anybody, but that meant to me, I was good enough that Paul Heyman, who is a brilliant guy, he trusts me to main event pay-per-views. He trusts me to carry the torch and to be in the mix of top storylines. So as a performer, it just said, hey, you got to a certain level where I could bank on you. And we were making moves to go to TNN and to become more global.
Yeah.
So that was a huge honor. So that's more what it meant to me. Not actually that I got a leather belt with some metal. It was like, you know, you guys are saying, hey, we believe in you to be good enough to carry that in future endeavors. So, yeah, it was an honor. And to this day, it's something that I hold with a lot of pride.
Yeah, it was awesome. And part of the package as well, Francine, who I believe is one of the most underrated valets / managers of all time. So she's managed like a few of the champions going through. So what was she like as part of the package? Because she could draw heel heat like no one else.
Oh yeah, no, Francine was great. She was wonderful, very easy to work with. Strictly always business. You know, she was very smart. And was willing to do whatever as far as like, you know, if we needed her to take a bump. I remember one time I was working with Shane Douglas, and this was Heyman's idea, but she was role reversal. She was with Shane at the time.
Right.
And I was going to cane shot him in the head, unprotected. And the gimmick was for her to take the bullet for him and step in, and I would cane her in the head. And she was great. I mean, I didn't hurt her, which was a bonus. But she was, okay, I'll do it. And then later on, she admitted how nervous she was. But she was a trooper, man. She really loved the business and worked very hard at her craft. You know, it is a shame she never got more of a chance because she was a very, very smart, good, hardworking young woman and a beautiful young woman as well.
Oh, yeah. You know. And speaking of Canes, Sandman, you had some great matches with Sandman. So he's a bit rough around the edges, but we love him. What's he like to be around?
Oh, he's great, dude. He's honestly, what you see is what you get.
Yeah.
I mean, last time we were with each other, which is funny, we had agreed, and this is where COVID kind of killed us. We had a tour booked in comedy clubs in America. Called the it was a three-man extreme show where, like, how Mick Foley and Jim Ross kind of go to clubs and talk about their story in wrestling. I was the booker of this whole thing. It was my idea. Myself, Shane Douglas, and Sandman, we were going to travel the circuit and talk about ECW, the three of us. So we had that booked, and Sandman is just you know, just so smart. People don't think he's a smart dude. He is, like, he knows more trivia stuff than I do. He knows more about politics, like current politics. He's ridiculous. Like, he stays up to date with everything. Like, he, you know, he was, I mean, he ran his own company. He had a construction company. He's, like, super smart in the stock market. Like, he's plugged in. What you see is completely what you get, which is shocking. You were going to expect me to say something else. He's a complete nut bar, but he's also a smart crazy, which is weird. Like, because he does talk like this. Yo, Justin, what's going on? You know, but he's got another layer to him. It's like he could turn it on and off. And yeah, he's awesome. I loved working with him. Awesome. He's a good friend.
Yeah, and so, I mean, when towards near the end of ECW, so what was the reaction of everyone when you saw Paul Heyman appear on Raw? I spoke to Rob Van Dam about it a few months ago, and he said at first, he said, I felt sorry for him because it was like he was looking for a job. He said, well, then I understood what happened. I'm like, yeah, my opinions was a bit different, but what was the opinions of yourself in the locker room when you saw him pop up on Raw?
Well, here's a funny story. The night he popped up, I popped up.
Oh, right. That's right. Isn't it? Yeah.
And you know how I knew? I didn't tell anybody. I emailed. This was in the beginning of AOL. Remember the old...
To AOL?
All right. I emailed Jim Ross and got a job. And I was supposed to debut at the Nassau County Coliseum in Long Island, New York, about an hour from Manhattan. An hour from MSG. Anyways, long story short, that was where we're all was. And Heyman gives me a call as I'm driving to the building. I'm an hour late already on my first day. And he goes, PJ. Yes, Paul. Which I thought was weird that he's calling me, because I knew nothing was happening. Yeah. Why aren't you at the building yet? I'm like, what are you talking about? What building? He goes, why aren't you at Long Island? I'm like, he goes, I'm already here. So he was already there. And right. I was there. Like, he played everybody, dude.
Yeah.
He was there before any of us were there. And I wasn't trying to be underhanded, but I knew for a fact. I mean, I worked the last official match for ECW.
That's right.
Actually, the last one was Sandman and myself.
That's right.
That was the last ever match. So it's like, so why are you holding on, dude? What are you holding on to? Why are you preventing other people from making moves in this hostile environment where people maybe can't land jobs? So it's like, if I didn't make the move, I would have been the mark, you know? So it's just, it's just more craziness. And that's where my feelings for Paul kind of start to fade. And I think a lot of people's do, is because he could never just, you know, business is business. That's cool. I get it. But you're playing me. You're calling me, telling me, where are you? Where, you know, he already knew. He's already in touch with the office. He knew what I was doing.
Yeah.
How would you know that if, you're not debuting on the same night, motherfucker? Really? Yeah. So it's always like, you always felt like a kid that was out of touch. He was 10 steps ahead of you.
Yeah. It's crazy. And was it sad to see the doors finally close in ECW? Because I'll be honest, Justin. So, like, during this time, so 2001, I was 11 year old. And over here in the UK, as a kid, I never had much access to ECW. For example, my first time seeing you, I didn't realize you was Aldo Montoya because I was a kid, but I saw you was just incredible, and the invasion angle, which we'll get to. So going back and watching it now a lot, which I have, I love it. So what did it feel like for yourself when you saw them doors close in ECW?
It sucked. I would have stayed there, honestly, as long as I could have. It was family, but more than that, just from a business point of view, and Paul goes into in depth with it. He did a couple of podcasts with Stone Cold about it, where ECW, the year it went under in 2000, was actually the most financially profitable year that ECW had ever had. And it's true, because I remember going to pay-per-views and television tapings where we were sold out 5,000-6,000 people in major markets. So we were growing. It's just the bad business that he had done throughout the early years to catapult him to, it finally caught up with him, and he couldn't barter any more money. And it was literally, I think, 3 or 4 months that he couldn't buy, because I think Vince offered him a sweetheart deal that he couldn't say no to. Shit we don't know about. Because put it this way, I think the pay-per-view companies, they give, I think it's like a 90 to 120 days where you cannot receive your money. And if Paul would have gotten the money from the pay-per-view companies, at a certain date, we would have been fine. But then it didn't happen, and the creditors put it into bankruptcy. It was simple as that. But yeah, it broke everyone's heart, because it was such a unique, wonderful experience. Like my wife worked for the company. She was making, $150 a night to work merchandise, which may not sound like a lot or a big deal, but it was, because I'm also making $3,000 a week. And together as a family, we're traveling the world, doing what I love, and she loved traveling and working. You know, we're doing this as a family, and it's not like you're not selling your soul to the devil of the WWE and doing it independently. So there's that independent spirit, almost like that punk rock and roll spirit of, we're doing this on our own terms. And it was beautiful. And there was a lot of love there. And the fans were so amazing. And it was just a huge legacy that I don't think, if you weren't there, people won't understand it, because it was so special. Words won't do it justice. It was just a very special time. So, it hurt. And I realized it the first minute you step back into a WWE ring. Of course, everyone was welcoming. I was, after the first week, the first road trip I went on was me, Triple H, Steven Regal, and X-Pac. So it's not like I wasn't involved with guys of priority. It was just a different animal. And I just don't fit into that mold, because with that mold comes a lot of politics and deceit, which I'm not comfortable with. I'm a very, I don't roll that way for some reason. I just can't do it. I don't do it well.
They paired you back up with Sean Waltman, X-Pac, paired you up with Albert's X-Factor, which we all love the Fame song. You wrecked the pre-show, I suppose you could say, for WrestleMania X7, which is the greatest mania of all time. So
yeah,
what was it like working that size of an audience? I can only imagine.
it was ridiculous. And the one thing I could take away from that was, I never worked a WrestleMania, and there were 65,000 people there. It was in Houston at the Astrodome, and I just couldn't. It was just like, okay, have you ever been to the beach where the ocean is?
Yeah.
Like looking out into the ocean and seeing people. It's all it looked like, was just like a sea of never-ending people. And this is what you want when you're a kid dreaming of this. But that was cool. And I'm glad I had that experience. But you're also in there for 3 minutes with Steve Blackman and Grandmaster Sexy.
Yeah.
Even though we went over, still it was what it was. But it was cool, dude. I'll never forget it. Just to have that experience where I went out there to the stage area and I'm like, oh my God. I've wrestled in front of sold out Madison Square Garden. I've been to the O2 in London. I've been to famous arenas, but that was just like, I've never seen that many people in my life, Yeah. So it was cool. It was very cool.
Awesome. And you was part of the invasion angle. So it was like seeing some of you. Not many people got over from it. If anyone outside WWE, you could say Booker T got over from it and RVD, and that was pretty much it. Everyone else got buried. I can imagine it was fun at the time being around all your ECW brethren, but how did it feel when they told you creative? And it's like,
It was horrible, dude. And we knew it was going to be horrible, because I don't remember the angle specifically, but I do remember it was in Atlanta, We were doing Raw. It was me and I think Raven against the Dudleys. And I don't, again, I don't remember what it was, but we were supposed to be fighting one another. And at the end, we ended up hugging. And it was like nine, it was like at the first, the end of the first hour of Raw. And so they announced ECW, like Taz came out, a bunch of ECW people came out. ECW has reformed for the invasion, you know, before the W. So everybody popped. The building was so on fire for that. 1 hour later, we got put back out there again. And that's when they claimed that WCW and ECW are now one. And we're going to call it the Alliance. From the big pop we got in the beginning of the show or the end of the first hour to the Alliance announcement, the crowd just shit on it. And that's how I could say that that went down. Because realistically, that invasion angle should have been the biggest angle in pro wrestling history.
Yeah.
If they would have done it as a three, like WWF, ECW, WCW, and kept it that way and let it just run off of its merit of three separate companies doing what they do, fans would buy that. Except they kept it. They did this contrived, fake ass bullshit that even though it did well financially, it did half of the numbers that it could have done if they would have just kept it to what fans really wanted, which is, you know, it's a shame because they had so much potential, man. So the whole angle, they had everybody they could have wanted. They just chose not to. They chose not to bring in Sting and others. And it was just, it was a botched job from the beginning.
Yeah. And they eventually finished the angle and you got released and you was on the indies for a bit and you made a stint in TNA, but they brought you back for ECW One Night Stand 05. Lance Storm's, I suppose, one of his last matches. I think he's had matches since. But you also done a stint in Wrestling Society X. So what's it like working that? It's a bit of a... It's got a little bit of a cult status now. I spoke to Jimmy Jacobs about it, and he was like, yeah, we actually get it a lot, but people loved it. So what was your time like working on
it? I thought it was cool. I thought it was fun. I thought it was ahead of its time, certainly.
Yeah.
The only problem was that, was you can't sell pro wrestling to a network without having good pro wrestling people involved. Yeah. And I think it stemmed, and I don't even know who the people were. I'm not like disrespecting anybody intentionally, but I think the problem was the people that were running it were not pro wrestling people. So that's truly, you know, because that's one thing Vince has always done is he had the best people that knew pro wrestling to kind of help. And then, of course, you bring in television people, but Wrestling Society X was selling a product to MTV, but then not having wrestling people there and just having corporate people that are representing MTV, then it gets all kinds of messed up, you know?
Yeah. And you made your return again to WWE in 2006 for the ECW return. So at One Night Stand that year, Rob Van Dam finally became champion, having that great match with John Cena. So you knew the guy for many years. So what was it like seeing RVD finally become, even though I know it was the original ECW title, it still felt like an ECW show when you watch it, especially with the fans. The fans were great that night. So what was it like being part of that?
It was great. I mean, both of them. The first One Night Stand was the best. And then even the second one. But the second one, you could already tell because Bradshaw was there with his people from WWF or WWE then. You know, the second one was a lot more WWE. Yeah. But it felt good. It felt good. And I thought we had a shot. You know, Rob was definitely the guy out of all of us to do that. And, you know, it's just Vince never, ever took ECW more serious than he does NXT. I think originally that's what he thought ECW would have been for him before NXT concept was, look, we'll have them be our feeder. And, but, you know, he saw money in it. He saw fans. And fans never really got to give a proper goodbye to ECW. So it was kind of like a love song to ECW.
Yeah.
But when it got relaunched to a show, it was just brutal. It was brutal. Yeah. I did this as I wrestled for WWE on three separate contracts. The first one, I asked for my release, and I got to go to ECW because Paul Heyman got that contract. The second one, I did get fired for breaking, and I won't get into it, but for breaking my contractual obligations. And the third one, I quit straight up because I felt they were jobbing me out. I mean, I was the best thing I could say from that era was I put over CM Punk in his debut.
That's right, yeah.
And then the rest was like I was jobbing to Balls Mahoney and Sabu, which I didn't mind Sabu, but every week I'm getting jobbed out. But the thing is, the money was also horrible. The day that killed it for me and the day I quit was I went to I had to go to the airport to fly out for TV. It was a Tuesday morning. TV was at Tuesday night. So we had the show, or for America at least, was Tuesday night live after SmackDown taping. I went to the bank and I didn't have funds.
Right.
And I'm like, really? And it's not like I was mismanaged. I was making, if I told you, you wouldn't believe me, but it was less than 52 grand a year. Right. Which I know it may still sound like a lot to people, but you're also on the road. I'm in the negative here.
Yeah.
Because we have to pay taxes on that money. WWF doesn't or WWE doesn't because we're independent contractors. Yeah. Remember that one? That big controversy? Yeah. So I'm losing money. I'm losing money. And I don't have enough money to just get to the airport. I quit. I cracked. I just didn't show. Then they called me up and Johnny Ace said, oh, we understand. Just go to the next show. They sent me a ticket. I never showed up. I was like, fuck you, dude. You'll never see me again. And that was it. Yeah. They sent me my release, which I don't regret. To this day, I don't regret because they disrespected all the ECW guys and gals.
Yeah. Apparently, that's fine. Apparently, one of the original ideas, so from what I've heard, Shane McMahon has always been a fan of it. And I think one of his original ideas, it was rather during his time or beforehand, he wanted to bring ECW back as an online show, but with the old school feel of ECW, like not PG and just go for it. So
yeah,
there's a lot of people that's hoping Shane does take over one day, but we'll see.
The old man couldn't let it go because he always, to this day, he always believes that if it's not WWE, it's not. You know, the one thing is, I got hired on the merits of like what the business was saying, on what Meltzer and the Sheets would say, on what the magazine. Vince McMahon never saw any ECW matches. I remember being on the first one night stand, and I was in the gorilla position, and Vince was on the monitor, and him and Jerry Briscoe, they were playing a package about Chris Candido. And they were also implicating the Impact players because Chris and Lance had teamed. They were just trying to set up Lance and Jericho.
Yep.
And they're both asking the question, was Chris Candido an Impact player? Like, anybody that knows wrestling would know that. They never watched any. Dude, they don't watch any of this shit. They sign people on the recommendation of what's going on in the business. They never themselves sit there and watch tape. You would think they do. Like coaches for all major sports. Yeah. They don't.
Yeah.
They had no idea what the real Justin Credible had done. They just heard. So they never really understood what was needed to get these guys over. They didn't really care. They just wanted the names.
Yeah. I mean, you still see it these days, Justin, with, for example, whenever WWE signs a star from TNA/Impact, Bobby Roode, like in TNA, he's one of the top guys. He was one of the best world champions there for a while. And since he's been brought over, he's been an afterthought. They just stick him in random tag teams. And so it's something that's still, you know, precedent these days. So I don't think it'll ever change. And don't get me wrong, I thank Vince McMahon for the years of entertainment he's given me watching WWE. But it is time for him to step aside, but I don't think that day will come till he actually passes away.
All right. Yeah, I agree. And it's a shame because when WWE has its back against the wall, that's when they're the most lethal. That's when they realize wrestling's not that hard. With the internet and with everything and all the natural angles, that happened, just in wrestling fans' minds and in just the natural progression of things. It doesn't take a lot of far-fetched booking to come up with good storylines. If they would have just kept ECW and WCW and WWF separate, and then we finally collide in a Super Bowl-style pay-per-view of the best wrestlers in the world, that's all you need for fans, except they got to go hokey. They got to go completely BS. And fans are just too smart now. And it's not even that fans are watching AEW in droves. They're just done. I think fans are just done with wrestling. We have a bigger problem. You know, and they, like, everybody thinks like, oh, well, now that NXT's moved over after WrestleMania, AEW is going to... No, they're not. I guarantee you they're going to stick to the same numbers, maybe a little better.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think we have a real problem where wrestling fans are just like, I'm done with this. I really do. Wrestling's like, so they're telling me it's more popular than ever, where I don't see it. I don't see it. I don't see it.
Yeah. I mean, I saw it, and all respect to him, Brian Pillman Jr. loved his father, which I would imagine you did yourself.
Yeah, I know them very well. Yeah, yeah, but I hear what you're saying.
He treated that saying, you know, wrestling is mainstream again. And I'm like, I'm
no,
sorry.
It's not.
It's
no, it's
far
ain't.
From mainstream. I'm sorry. And it's I not. Like him. I like
do too.
Him.
He's a good, he's a good kid. Talent. But look, wrestling's anything but cool.
Yeah.
Because they don't do anything to make it cool. The biggest thing they do not do is involve it in, like, there are no pop culture references. Go on TikTok. And I don't, I just learned about TikTok. I don't post on TikTok, but I watch what my kids watch, like 21-year-olds, 16-year-olds. So that's my kids' age limits. And if you would just take little bits and pieces of the flavor that they're giving you, it's like, hey, guys, this is what we like. At least make an effort to find a character that they're just so out of touch. Like, nothing is cool. Like, what made wrestling, and a huge part of pro wrestling has always been the music. That's half the reason that ECW made it was the music. Enter Sandman, my theme song, Van Damme's theme song. I mean, there was so much cool stuff. Get musical groups involved. I don't care if you have to kick them a percentage. Don't use that generic shit you guys have for these wrestlers. Use cool music of the era.
Yeah.
Have them come in and maybe perform on your show like they did with that Bad Bunny kid, which I don't even know any of his music, but whatever, that's not my place. Like, do other stuff to get fans involved. And they're like so far from doing that. They're so uncool. Like, wrestling fans are like, they won't tell you they're wrestling fans because they know they're going to be like looked
true,
at.
True.
I don't tell anybody I'm a wrestler, dude.
Yeah.
Anybody, if you don't know me, I'm not telling you. I'm embarrassed.
Yeah, when I say I've got podcasts, people's like, what do you do? I'm like, wrestling.
I used to go there thinking it was cool until it became uncool. Seriously. You know,
it's true. We're a very, very small audience. But unfortunately, especially online. And like I said, I like going online speaking to fellow wrestling fans, but wrestling fans are in that, and Russo explains it perfectly, that bubble.
Yeah.
They really think wrestling is massive, and I'm like, no, and don't get me wrong, I'm 31, I've been watching wrestling since I've been 3 years old, okay, so I do love wrestling. I know it's the furthest thing from being big at this. It's people try to say the Attitude Era was overrated and things like that. I'm like, no, you got no idea. But that's modern fans for you. Unfortunately, they don't really understand it. But speaking of understanding, you've got a great podcast with Vince Russo, what you've been doing, so... tell everyone about it.
We do a I work for his network. It's The Brand, and we do an AEW review show every Friday, so it's been really cool. We've watched literally every single episode since its inception, since its start, and we just give an honest, you know, again, it's just opinion, but we give our honest opinion, and you know, it's pretty cool. It's very educated. I would think. I mean, we always speak from like the numbers, and we try to really dig down. So we just try to give fans the best perspective that we can offer. You know, it's a fun listen, you know. So I love it. I love working with Vince. Like I said, I never knew Vince from his days at the WWE, because once Vince left, I was, or once Vince got there, I was already gone. In ECW. Well, when he got into Power, because he was there under the WWE magazine as a writer, as Vic Venom. So I never got to work with Vince. But, you know, even though everybody in the internet world seems to not like him very much, he's one of the kindest people I've been, you know, I had the pleasure of working with. So, you know, he's awesome. And if anybody's into it, man, check it out. It's really cool.
I'll be sure to promote it. And the final question, I suppose. So if you was Tony Khan right now, which would be nice, we'll all be mega wealthy.
Yes.
They got Jericho, but Jericho, you know, he's coming to the end of his career, safe to say. If you was Tony Khan, would you break the bank to try and bring CM Punk in? Because he's the only person I can actually see who would do it.
Yes. Yeah. I've said this more than once, and I'll say it again. CM Punk is probably the only guy, not to say that would make anybody, you know, great or whatever, but look, he gave his whole life to this business. I like him very much. I worked with him many times. He's a wonderful man. Always been very good to me. Nothing against Chris or CM Punk. Phil. But anywho, I almost feel like he's got the world of wrestling kind of on his shoulders, because if I choose to go somewhere, I could tip the scales, the balance of power. It's like, bro, that's like almost power that you can't deny. Just for ego's sake, I would go for it. But then again, that's a lot to ask someone. Maybe, I mean, he could be totally happy in his life, and I'm sure he is.
Yeah,
that's unfair for me to say. But as a fan, you know, and I am a fan, he could tip the balance of power, and it would be so interesting. I mean, and it would be a great ass kicking to the McMahons if he could pull that off. It would be a challenge I would love to fucking see. Let's say that, you know.
Awesome. Well, Justin, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. Great time. Thank you.
It's been, I could talk to you all night. So thank you.
Yeah.
A lot of fun.
We'll do a part two one day. But before we do sign off, where can everyone find you on their social media?
Absolutely. Just hit me up on Twitter at PJ Polacco, P-O-L-A-C-O. Also the same on Instagram at PJ Polacco. And of course, prowrestlingtees.com/Justin Credible. I have over 20 new designs, old designs, Aldo and ECW Justin. So please check it out. And that's all.
Cool. And like I said, absolute pleasure. And whenever we get free time, we'll definitely do it again one day.
Absolutely. Thank you, mate. Awesome. Cool.
Hey everyone, thanks for watching this interview. Hope you enjoyed it. And next week's guest. So coming in next week, one of the stars from the New Generation era, and also in late days of WCW, Brian Clark, aka Adam Bomb. A great chat to Brian. Talked about him joining WWE back in 1993. Some fun stories on the likes of the Kliq, Lex Luger, Bret Hart, Owen Hart, and the British Bulldog, and then what led to his departure from WWE, moving to WCW, tag teaming up with the late Brian Adams as part of Chronic. They returned to WWE, their disastrous match against The Undertaker and Kane, what really happened behind the scenes, and what he's been doing since. So, great chat to Brian. And while you're here, if you want to head over to manscaped.com, use my code 90s, you can get 20% off free shipping. And I promise you, I wouldn't ask them to sponsor me if I didn't believe in their product, but their product is really good. You get the Lawnmower 3.0. Basically, it's simple as this. Okay, it comes with a ceramic blade. No more nasty cuts or no more nasty accidents, basically. It's waterproof, so you can groom yourself in the shower. And it's also got LED light to highlight them areas what you probably missed before. So head over to manscaped.com. Use my code 90s, that's 90s, to get 20% off and free shipping. And for everyone else who wants to support the channel, if you could drop us a big old subscribe button on whichever platform you listen on, rather it be on podcast form or on YouTube, that'd be great. Give us a like, share with your friends, comment, do all that, and it really does help the channel out, and I can keep trying to bring you these great interviews. So until next time, thanks again, and I'll catch you down the road. Bye.